Okay guys, good evening. So we are back again with F9 chapter, which is state and local governments part 1, right? Though we did try to cover some of the parts in yesterday's webinar, so I'm just trying to brush up again what we have read yesterday, right? So first, module number 1, which is governmental accounting, right? So what we discussed on the governmental accounting overview was, so basically there are a lot of the steps and objectives of governmental accounting. What we discussed yesterday was how, what is the objective of fund accounting? Basically the objective of fund accounting is fiscal reporting, and one is operational accounting and one is fiscal accounting, right? So that's what you you might be seeing. So what all are the government's owned hospitals and all, they all comes under the governmental accounting. So anything which is owned by the government, strictly GASB will apply for it. So governmental, not-for-profit and commercial accounting are applied to entities consistent with their base of organization and their funding sources, come on their industries. So hospitals could be governmentally funded and accounted for using an enterprise fund, which could be organized as a not-for-profit or could be organized as a private businesses that report income and profitability to their shareholders. So although this can be confusing in practice, the CPA exam is generally very clear as to the manner in which an entity is organized and the applicable accounting principles. So basically, if it is owned by the government, typically GASB, which is Governmental Accounting Standard Board, will apply. If it is not owned by the government, right, if any private entity is owning a hospital, so FASB will apply, which is Financial Accounting Standard Board. So what basically we are looking for is a basic concepts, right? So industries that use the government accounting and all, so that can be government units, that can be colleges and universities, that can be healthcare organization as well. So organization that provide healthcare services includes hospitals. So you might have a hospital which is owned by the government, you might have a college or university which is owned by the government or non-governmental entities. So depending on whether they are financially accountable to the primary government, in case they are primarily accountable, then GASB will apply. So why are we discussing so much is which standards I need to apply, because as and when, if we come to know that governmental accounting standard board will apply, and accordingly, we need to cover in all the notifications of the GASB and the accounting principles and standards which are mentioned as per the governmental accounting standard board needs to be applied. So what is a government accounting standard board, which is a governmental counterpart of the FASB? So they have established the accounting and reporting standards by the government, right? So basically, you might see here, so they establish the accounting and standard boards, standards for the government. So the hierarchy of the GAAP as it relates to the government was established by GASB 76. So you have GASB accounting standard board statements and GASB technical bulletin, which is GASB implementation guides, right? So government entities should consult this guidance. So the moment we come to know that it's government owned and the government accounting principles need to be applied, accordingly we need to kind of apply the GASB standards. So then again, the GASB has outlined its, okay, so there are governmental type and business type activities. So government entities engaged in both governmental type and business type activities. Each type of activity requires accounting and reporting standards that address their individual characteristic and user needs. So governmental type activities are typically supported by taxes and business type activities are supported by user fees. This is a very, very important point. Very, very important as for the AICP exams. Time and again, they have asked this question. So governmental type activities are typically supported by taxes and business type activities are supported by user fees. This is a very, very important thing. So who are the users of the government financial reporting? One is the citizens, then you have the, which is includes the taxpayers, then you have legislative and oversight bodies, then you have investors and creditors. So these are the users of the governmental financial reporting. Nothing much to talk about in the first module. Basically, this is just for your information so that we are aware. So what all are the users of the financial reporting? So you can compare the actual with budget, you can assess the financial conditions, it will help in determining compliance, right? So these are some of the users of the financial reports. So accountability and intra-period equity. So accountability is what? So whatever is there, so government needs to provide the accountability. It needs to provide the financial information to the citizens to justify whether the raising of the resources and demonstrate the purpose for which they were used, right? So is a government accountable or not is what we need to check. If once I have determined that accountability is one of the important cornerstone of governmental financial reporting. So it is important for a government to know where the funds have been, how they have utilized and how they have raised the resources and demonstrate the purposes for which they are used. So this is one of the important features of the governmental accounting, right? Accountability. Second is the intra-period equity. Again, how they have used that money and how the taxpayers' money is used for that particular services, whether they have performed or not. So these are some of the things which are important in the governmental financial reporting, right? So what are the features? These are the same features like we have in the financial statements, which is understandability, reliability, relevance, and timeliness. So it should be understandable, it should be reliable, it should be relevant, and it should be in a timely manner. So account understandability, reliability, relevance, and timeliness. So same features what we have in the commercial accounting as well. The financial statement should be understandable, they should be reliable, they should be relevant, and they should be in a timely manner, they should be reported. Yep. So this is what basically we have in the, and again, the consistency and the comparability, it should be comparable and it should be consistent. There is a mnemonic here which talks about that, right? Your mice, which is understandability, reliability, make again, you are mice. So M stands for, so U stands for understandability, R stands for reliability, right? M again is for materiality, I is in timeliness, consistency, and again entity to entity comparability. So what are the limitations? Again, if you see the limitations, because there are again judgments based on governmental financial reporting, since it involves judgments and estimates, typically that is one of the limitation of the governmental financial reporting. What is the second limitation is the cost benefit relationship. These are some of the questions they keep asking in as an MCQs in governmental accounting limitations. So one popular answer would be that it is based on judgments or estimates, and second it would be that relationship must be considered, right? So what are the financial reporting objectives? Accountability, again, as we said, is a primary objective. How they have used, whether there were current year revenues were sufficient to pay for the current year services, whether we demonstrated budgetary, and whether they are in compliance with the legal laws, and how they have provided the information, whether the users are able to assess that particular information. So what are the fund structure basically for the governments? There are typically 11 funds which we'll be discussing in detail. I think we are, since we have started earlier 5:10, I think a lot of the candidates might join 15 to 20 minutes late. So Ajay and I think Abhas have joined in, so we might have a lot of candidates again now in next 5-10 minutes. So basically, I'm just giving an overview on what is this governmental accounting. So what are the fund structure? Basically, this is defined as so 11 fund types are classified in the following three generic categories. So one is governmental funds, second is a proprietary funds, third is a fiduciary funds. So fund financial statement should be separately presented for governmental, proprietary, and fiduciary funds to report additional and detailed information about the primary government. So a government will establish the minimum number of funds consistent with legal requirements and sound financial administration. A government is not required to have a specific number of funds. Again, very easy, guys. So this fund structure basically for the governments is three, basically three funds are there in the fund accounting. One is a governmental fund, second is a proprietary funds, third is a fiduciary funds. So what is about 11 fund? देखो भाई गवर्नमेंटल में बहुत सारे देर आर सब क्लासिफिकेशन, अगेन प्रोप्राइटरी में भी बहुत सारे सब क्लासिफिकेशन है, फिडिशियरी में ऑल्सो यू हैव लॉट ऑफ सब क्लासिफिकेशन, राइट? आई थिंक विनय हैव जॉइंड इन टू, ओके? सो फंड फाइनेंशियल स्टेटमेंट्स शुड बी सेपरेटली प्रेजेंटेड फॉर गवर्नमेंटल प्रोप्राइटरी एंड द फिडिशियरी फंड्स टू रिपोर्ट द एडिशनल एंड द डिटेल इन्फॉर्मेशन अबाउट द प्राइमरी गवर्नमेंट. सो दैट्स व्हाट वी आर डिस्कसिंग. So question number one, guys. So what, which of the following leads to use of fund accounting by a governmental organization? What do you think, guys? One, there should be a financial control, and second, there should be a legal restriction. What do you think is what's the answer? Yes, Vinay is there. Hi, Vinay. So which of the following leads to the use of fund accounting by the governmental organization? So both of them are very, very important. One, it is very important to have a financial control. Second, there should be a legal restrictions because they need to comply with the laws, right? So that's how you need to have a financial control and you need to have legal restrictions. So answer should be A. Yes, thank you, Abbas. So A is the correct answer. So this is very, very sensible kind of, you don't need to study anything in order to remember anything in the part one of governmental accounting. It's very common sense question. Which of the following lead to the use of fund accounting by a governmental organization? You need to have both the features, which is financial control, because it's important that where the money was being used. Second is a legal restriction, whether it is used in with respect to the legal compliances or not. Any doubts in the module number one, guys? Vinay, Abhas, Ajay. Then we are just waiting for some more because it's just 5:10. Any doubts with respect to the module one? It's just an introduction, basically. Yes, Vinay. Hello. Is any doubts with respect to the module one? Because this is just an introduction to the governmental accounting. So what is a government? What are the first of all government organizations? Like you have hospitals, you have something called colleges, you have universities which are run by the governmental entities. So anything which is run by government or anything where we are accountable to the primary government, definitely this module or this standards will apply for that thing, right? So that's one of the important things which you need to remember. So if it is not run by the government, which standard will apply? Which is FASB. If it is run by the government, they'll apply GASB. That is what is a module number one for you. Okay. So again, what are the characteristics? You have understandability, you have reliability, you have relevance, you have timeliness. So these are some of the, so your mice is a mnemonic for this particular thing. So module two. So now we are going into details. Basically, this is one of the important modules and a lot of questions keep coming from the fund structure and the fund accounting. So there are basically three types of funds. One is governmental fund. Second is proprietary funds. Third is fiduciary funds. As we discussed in our earlier module, there are three fund structure. One is governmental, second is proprietary, third is fiduciary funds. So in governmental funds, they are accounted using the modified accrual basis of accounting. And second is current financial resource measurement focus. So what is this fund accounting modified accrual basis? So basically they don't follow an accrual basis, rather they follow modified accrual basis. So they might recognize revenue even if it is belonging to the next year also. So there are some unique rules for accounting in governmental funds. So one such case is revenue. Even though if you are able to collect within 60 days, right, that can be classified as your revenue. So some of those examples are there where they deviate from the accrual basis and they follow modified accrual basis accounting. Second is a current financial resource measurement focus. So you will find in governmental funds, typically you will not have any long-term debt, you will not have any fixed assets. You'll have only current assets and current liability. You don't have any non-current kind of things in governmental funds. So this is a very, very important thing. There are a lot of questions which comes up on this. So if you see their statement of net position and statement of changes in net position, which is balance sheet and P&L, you might not find anything which is non-current. Only which is current is only found under fund accounting. You'll have nothing called non-current in governmental funds. So what are there in under governmental funds? So there is a mnemonic for this, which is GRASP. So I have just prepared a mnemonics here. I have just taken an extract from Becker. So this is GRASP, right? So GRASP, G stands for general, R stands for special revenue, S stands for GRA, S stands for debt service, P stands for capital project, again P stands for permanent. So this is what is a mnemonic, And one more mnemonic is MAGRASP. That means modified accrual accounting, current financial resources, and GRASP. So this is what, this is how you will remember this particular thing, because there are a lot of mnemonics being used in the governmental accounting in the Becker notes. So what basically we are telling is to remember this, the governmental funds are MAGRASP. That means what? It follows modified accrual accounting, and all the resources follows the current accounting. There are no non-current. And the mnemonic for the various types of funds are: first is general, second is special revenue, third is debt service, fourth is capital projects, fifth is permanent. So this is what you need to remember in this. Clear? So general fund. So what is a general fund? Basically, any taxes collected by the federal government will come under general fund, right? Which is as simple as it is. See, there the general fund is used to set up to account for the ordinary operation of government unit. So that is financed from taxes and other general revenues. All transactions not accounted in other funds are accounted for here. So general fund, basically in general fund, any collections or any taxes collected by the federal government will come under general fund. Very, very important point is this, right? Second is special revenue funds. What is special revenue funds? Special revenue funds are restricted or committed. So suppose there might be a motor fuel taxes, right, which is being levied by US. So that motor fuel taxes is for certain specific purposes, right, to build the roads and all. So in that particular case, this will fall under special revenue fund. What are debt service funds? So debt service funds are those funds which are used to fund the long-term debt obligations of the government, right? So they are set up to account, so you will pay the principal as well as the interest both from this particular fund. The name itself tells you that it's a debt service fund. So it will service all the debt obligations of the government. Very, very important definitions. These are not given in Becker in detail, so that's why I'm trying to explain to each and every fund, right? So general fund basically is nothing but the taxes collected by the US government will fall under general fund, and it is for the public welfare, right? And second is special revenue fund, which is specifically for certain purposes. Debt service fund will be used to pay out the interest and the principal obligations. Capital project funds, again, they are used for the governmental buildings, libraries, and all such things, right? So that all will come under capital project funds. And last but not least is permanent funds. So what are permanent funds? Basically, they are used to report resources that are legally restricted to the extent that income and not principal may be used for purposes supporting the reporting government's program, that is for the benefit of the public. Okay, so permanent fund, guys, this is a very, very interesting thing in permanent fund. If you see this, in permanent fund, what basically happens is, like Alaska is one of the state, right, in US. So Alaska have this permanent fund concept. So whoever is a citizen of Alaska, typically they are being given dividends by the government, by the state government. They have set up a permanent fund of Alaska, whereby the dividend income is distributed to the citizens of the Alaska. Sir, why is this so? Sometimes the government wants certain citizens to be in that particular state board, and they want to encourage that people be the citizens of that particular state. So that's how one of the permanent fund is being set up. So there the citizens get the free dividend from the government, actually, which is very, very I would say very strange, basically, but still in Alaska the citizens get the dividends from the government just for staying in Alaska. Are you getting it, guys? Just to stay in Alaska, the permanent funds, they give out the dividend. Important point to remember in permanent fund is the principal is never being spent. What is spent here is only the interest. That is very, very important, right? So principal cannot be spent in permanent fund, only the interest component. So when I tell interest in my example of Alaska, so only the dividends are being spent, not the capital investment which is being done in this particular fund, right? So the earnings which are used out of the funds will be used in the permanent fund. Okay, so what is a balance sheet looks like? Again, they have everything current, they don't have anything which is non-current, guys. That's why we kept a mnemonic here. See the mnemonic, you have MAGRASP, which is modified accrual accounting, right? And you have current financial resource measurement focus, and GRASP. What is GRASP? G stands for general fund, R stands for special revenue fund, S stands for again debt service fund, P stands for capital project, P again stands for permanent. So this is a way you need to remember this, MAG, GRASS, P. Okay, so only current asset and current liabilities are reported, nothing non-current is reported in this particular fund accounting, right? So statement of revenue, C, they call it as balance sheet, and P&L, they call it as statement of revenues, expenditure and changes in fund balance. See the word which is being used here, it is used as fund balance, right? Not the income statement, they call something called as statement of revenues, expenditures and changes in fund balances. This is a word which is being used. Okay, now we are coming to the proprietary funds. What we were discussing was governmental funds. Now we are going to proprietary funds. So what are proprietary funds? So two are there in proprietary funds. One is the internal service funds and second is the enterprise fund. So what is internal service funds? So they are used basically to support the other departments basically. So they are primarily internal, right? So they are being used on a cost reimbursement fee basis. They just support the other departments in their operations. So that are known as internal service funds. Again, in proprietary funds uses full accrual, right? And they uses economic resources measurement focus. That means what? They will report both current as well as non-current in their balance sheet. Very, very important point. So internal service funds, again, they are set up to account for goods. So they are basically used to support the other departments, right? So what is the second one? Second one is the enterprise fund. So they are being set up for the account of acquisition and operation of government facilities. So now if you are using the water facility and CHO facilities and all, the government charges you for that, right? So what are the funds which are being used for that particular thing, where you collect the revenues from that particular thing? That fund is known as enterprise funds. They are often used for utilities, airports and transit systems. See there the mnemonic here, what we have in proprietary and fiduciary funds. So proprietary and fiduciary funds, you have something called S-E-C-H-I-B-O-I. So S stands for service funds, E stands for enterprise funds in proprietary. Please remember the mnemonic. You have only two there. S stands for service funds, E stands for enterprise funds. So now we are coming to something called fiduciary funds. So what are fiduciary funds? So the mnemonic here is CIPO. C-I-P-P-O-E is a mnemonic for fiduciary funds. So what are fiduciary funds? One, the first one in C, what we have is custodial funds, right? So custodial funds are nothing but they collect on the behalf of government entities. So they are known as the custodial funds, right? So like taxes and all, in India, which is popularly known as GST, they're here, they call this as sales tax collections, which are collected on the behalf of government. That all comes under custodial funds. Second, you have the investment trust funds, which invest in certain securities. Third, you have CIP. Third P stands for private purpose trust funds. So, jaise purane zamane mein hote hai, so like there were a lot of kings, there were all rulers and all, and their properties got transferred. Once they die, they don't have any legal heirs, right? So that gets transferred to the government. So, government protects those properties. So that comes under private purpose trust funds. They are specifically those trust funds which has the custody or which are responsible for legally protecting their properties, right? For the private, of a private individual as such. So that are known as private purpose trust funds. So wo log custody mein rakhte hai aur unke asset ko roz dekhbhal karte hai jaise, right? So that is something like to do with private purpose trust funds. Or fourth, jo ki hai, pension trust funds. So what are pension trust funds? They are nothing but your defined benefit plans, defined contribution plans, which are employees ke hai. Those trust funds, they maintain the employees funds and also jo government ki related funds hai, that all comes under pension trust funds basically. So they account for the resources of defined benefit plans, defined contribution plans, post employment benefit plans and other long term employee benefit plans. See there you have something called statement of fiduciary net position, statement of changes in fiduciary net position. Previously you had statement of net position and statement of changes in fund net position for proprietary funds, right? Now in case of fiduciary funds, you have, what is the statement here? Statement of fiduciary net position and statement of changes in fiduciary net position. Sir, why is it so important? Please remember, a lot of multiple choice question comes from this particular thing only with the nomenclature. In fiduciary funds, we use statement of fiduciary net position and statement of changes in fiduciary net position. In case of proprietary funds, we use as statement of net position and statement of revenues, expenses, and changes in fund net position. So these are some of the important nomenclatures which you need to remember. See there, you have a mnemonic again. C, CPOE. So CPOE. So CPOE means what? So it's like C stands for custodial funds, I stands for investment trust funds, P stands for private purpose trust funds. Again, P stands for POE, which is pension and other employee benefit trust funds. So this is a mnemonic for this particular thing. Clear? Again, they uses what actually basically they record. So proprietary and fiduciary funds, they record non-current assets and liabilities. They use as accrual method and they have economic resource measurement focus. Governmental funds, again, what is a mnemonic? GRASP. What is GRASP? G stands for general fund. R stands for special revenue fund. S stands for debt service fund. Again, capital projects and permanent funds. So this is a mnemonic, MAC GRASP. They use as modified accrual accounting. They don't use full accrual. They use modified accrual and they report only current, not non-current, right? So that is about the funds. So what all are the funds which are being used, right? So there is a summary also which is being prepared. Governmental funds are MAC-GRASP. Proprietary and fiduciary funds are SCARE. So what is that SCARE? SCARE mnemonic is S stands for service funds and E stands for enterprise funds. CPOE we have already discussed. Accrual accounting, record non-current assets and liabilities. E stands for economic resources measurement focus. Okay guys, what is the question number one answer, guys? Yes, we have some new participants also. Namrita, what is the question number one answer? Namrita, Abhas, Ajay, Vinay. Yes, what's the question number one answer? Guys, is anyone listening here? Question number one, what's the answer basically? The economic resource measurement focus and accrual basis of accounting would be the most appropriate for which fund as used in fund financial statements. Yes guys, where do we use the full accrual method and economic resources? Which fund uses that? Yes, C is the correct answer. So internal service fund, as per our mnemonic, SE uses the accrual basis of accounting. See there, C, SE, CPOE, accrual accounting, record non-current assets and economic resources. So the answer is C, internal service fund uses the economic resources measurement focus and accrual basis of accounting. So question number one answer is C. Yes, what's the question number two answer, guys? Yes, Vinay, Namrita, what's the question number two answer? Yes, guys, what's the question number two answer? Again, C. So which funds would most appropriately use the current financial resources measurement focus and modified accrual? What did we discuss, guys? MAC-GRASP is what the mnemonic is. So modified accrual, current GRASP. So governmental funds will use the accrual, modified accrual basis. Proprietary and fiduciary doesn't use the modified accrual. They use what actually? They use full accrual and economic resource measurement focus. So this is what is the answer. So question number two answer is C, which is governmental funds. So they are the only funds which uses a current financial resources measurement focus and modified accrual basis of accounting. Okay guys, so we are done with module two, okay, which is nothing but fund structure and fund accounting, right? Fund structure and fund accounting. So we are done with this particular thing. Guys, any doubts in module number two? Any doubts in module number two? Yes, Namrita Singh, Vinay Kancham, Jabhas, Ajay, Yes, any doubts in model number 2? Vinay saying no. Yes, anyone else? Namrata? Is Namrata there? Yes, Abhas. Okay, then we can proceed to module number 3. Okay. So we are going to one of the important modules here, which is module number 3, transactions and events, part 1, F9, module number 3. So just a quick summary for you guys. So governmental funds are MAC, GRASP, modified accrual accounting, current financial resource measurement focus, and GRASP. So this is a mnemonic which we use. And proprietary fiduciary funds are SKR, right? So S stand for internal service fund, E stands for enterprise fund, C stands for custodial, I stands for investment trust, then you have private purpose trust, then you have pension, and O stands for other employee benefit obligation. So that is the thing, you use as accrual method, you record non-current as well as economic resource measurement. So in this module, we will discuss in detail about GRASP. So you will study the entire in-depth about GRASP. So again, governmental funds have no profit motive. They don't have any income statement. They don't have any matching principle. They don't follow accrual method. What is the method they follow? It is known as modified accrual method. That is budget, activity, and encumbrances. So that is known as the mnemonic is BAE. Right? BAE. So B stands for budget, A stands for activity, E stands for encumbrance. So they have a specific budget, guys. So these governmental funds, since they don't have any income statement or profit objective, so it doesn't make any sense to follow the accrual method. So what they follow here is the budget, activity, and encumbrances method. They have a budget. They specify that this is what is the amount we need to use. Then again, once that gets approved and all, they spend it. So spending actual amounts is known as activity. Again, encumbrances may they kind of record the purchase orders. So that is very, very important, right? So what is the passkey here? Yeah, they use BA. So BAE, book the budget, book the activity, and book the encumbrances. Again, close the budget, close the activity, and close the encumbrances. So this is a mnemonic which is being used in Becker actually. So you will book the budget first. In the opening entry, you will book the budget, you will book the activity, and you will book the encumbrances. And again, at the year end, you will close the budget, close the activity, and close the encumbrances with the same amount. That is what is very, very important. Okay, so there are a lot of mnemonics here. So budgetary accounting is used by the GRASP funds, right? So what are the sources of governmental accounting? So what is a journal entry basically? So first journal entry, see, you might have seen that typically in our accounts or in our financial reporting, revenue is always credited. See here, revenue is basically debited in this journal entry. If you see that debit estimated revenue control and credited is given as appropriations of 1950 and you have a surplus of 50. Okay, so to explain you this, so what basically is happening is government have approved a budget of $2 million. Out of this, $1.95 million have been spent. So whatever is unspent is my surplus, which will be showing on the credit side, right? So this is how you need to understand. So whatever is credited in our accounting, here it will be debited. So it works on the reverse side. So revenue will be debited, credit will be appropriations, and whatever is a balancing figure should be the positive or surplus if you have on credit side. If you have on debit side, it will be negative or deficit. Again, at the end of the year, you will close back with the exact revenue. See there, you close back with the same amount. Appropriations is debited, budgetary control. You have a positive will be debited and credited will be the revenue control. So what you're doing basically is you're just booking a budget, you're booking an activity, right? And again, you're booking a budget and then reversing out the same budget because you have prepared a budget, basically. The budget is prepared on an intention that you are estimating that this is what is spent, you will do it. And actually you have done that much spent on, you will have a surplus or a deficit to that particular extent, okay? So what about activity? Again, you have in activities. So as we have completed this, so the journal entries are very, very important, guys. They might ask a lot of questions in this module only on the journal entries. Appropriation is debited, Budgetary control is debited, see there, and credit is given to estimated revenue control. And in the year end, you will just reverse the, sorry, this is a year end entry. At the beginning, you will have the reverse of revenue. Normally, revenue shows on the credit side. You will debit the revenue, credit the appropriations, credit the budgetary control. Okay. Now we are coming to the activities. So once you have booked the budget, now exactly how much you have spent is what will be the activity. This will use full accrual only, and there will not be any opposite sides, right? So this is a proper accounting what we have in activities. So what are the types of non-exchange revenues? So these are the derived tax revenues, right? So these are derived because they are sales tax and income tax. So till you don't have the income tax return, till you don't submit the income tax return, till you don't submit the sales tax return, the government cannot collect the taxes, right? So that's why they are known as derived tax revenue, because they are dependent on the information which is provided by the citizens. Second is imposed non-exchange revenues. So they represent taxes imposed on non-exchange transactions, fines or wealth. So it's like majorly like wealth taxes, like property taxes and fines. So these are such things. So revenue recognition in governmental funds is always subject to modified accrual standard. Receivable, however, are recognized if the government has enforceable claim. Recognized revenue will be adjusted to the amount available through the allowance amount account or deferred inflow of resources account. So what are the journal entries basically look like? So here you have something called property taxes receivable. You have credited with revenue 1620 and you have a bad debts which is $180,000. So what we have done here is the moment you have the accrued, the moment the government levies a property tax, you have recorded a receivable. Please understand this, guys. This is not an accrual method. This is modified accrual method. Though it is a mixture of accrual, it doesn't look like an accrual method. Hope you're getting it, guys. So because here we can recognize revenue even if we have collected within 60 days of the next financial year also, you can still recognize the revenue in your books. What is a 60 days rule? So if you are able to collect the next 2 months revenue today itself, if you are in a position to collect within 60 days your revenue, you can recognize that revenue in your books, even though if it belongs to the next financial year, right? So here you have property tax receivable debited. You have credited revenues with 1620. You have a provision for bad debts, which is allowance for uncollectible taxes, which is 180, right? Again, when you collect the property tax, you will debit the cash and you will credit the real property tax receivable. Some of the property taxes receivable have been become delinquent. Delinquent in terms is it's like they haven't been able to collect properly, right? It again will increase your provision for bad debt. So previously you had in provision 1,80,000, now you will have 3,42,000. Why, sir? Because you have another 1,62,000 which is as delinquent, right? So see there, the revenue of property taxes which is 1,62,000. So see here, general entry to reclass current allowance for uncollectible taxes to delinquent and adjust revenue to accrue the available amount. So revenue previously recognized 16,20,000 minus the measurable. So how much you have recognized? Basically 14,58,000 only you have recognized. So 1,62,000 revenue you will reverse out to that particular extent. Very, very important is this particular thing. Guys, any doubts in this journal entry? Guys, any doubts in this particular journal entry? So that we can go to the next topic.
I didn't understand this 14.58.
Who's that?
Ajay.
See, Ajay, what's basically it's happening is, see, previously you had a property tax receivable, right? So you recorded a receivable with 18,00,000, right? Then you have credited your revenue with 1620, right? All of that you have received, out of this 18, you have received 14,58. Are you getting this? Out of this 18, you have received 14,58. You haven't received the 342. As I was telling you, this is not an accrual method. This is a modified accrual method. If you haven't collected anything, you cannot recognize the revenue for that particular thing. As simple as it is. You need to reverse the revenue. टिपिकली हम लोग हमारे अकाउंटिंग में कैसे करते हैं, जब तक अक्रू नहीं होता है तब तक हम लोग रेवेन्यू रिकॉग्नाइज नहीं करते, राइट? हियर वी आर, वी कैन रिकॉग्नाइज द रेवेन्यू प्रोवाइडेड इफ वी हैव कलेक्टेड द मनी, राइट? इवन दो इट माइट नॉट हैव अक्रूड, बट इफ आई हैव कलेक्टेड इट आई कैन रिकॉग्नाइज द रेवेन्यू. But in this case, I was not able to collect that particular. Out of 18, I have received only 14,58. I haven't received 3,42. To that extent, I will reverse out the allowances. Are you getting it, guys? So actually, what I'm doing is this 1,80,000 of provision, I have increased it to 3,42,000. I have increased it more by $1,62,000. Is it clear, Ajay? Are you able to understand this? Yes, Ajay, are you able to understand this? Hello?
Yes.
So are you getting it? Because we are not following accrual method. We are following modified accrual method here.
Yeah, understood.
But to receive the cash, you will not recognize the revenue for it. As simple as it is. Out of 18, I have received 1458. So I will not recognize that particular thing. So since you are not recognizing, to that extent, you should reverse your receivables also. So see there, I have reversed my receivables also to that extent. I have reversed my revenue also to that extent. Are you getting it? So revenue, if you see that, you have already had a revenue. See, bad debts kya hai boss? It is nothing but your revenue provision, right? It reduces your revenue, right? So you have already reduced your revenue to the extent of 1,80,000. You need to reduce your revenue more by 1,62,000. That's why revenue is debited in this particular case. Clear? Any doubts in this, guys? Anyone who is having doubts in this journal, because this is one of the most important journal entries, there are fair chances that a lot of questions can come in this particular part itself. This is one of the tougher topics in the governmental accounting. And this particular thing which we are discussing about the journal entries, this looks to be one of the most challenging journal entries, because people get confused, and in your simulations, they might ask this journal entry for sure. This can be asked as an essay type question. You can mark it as 3 stars and put it as a very, very important question. If you want, guys, I can explain this again also. Even just let me know, guys, if you are not able to understand this. If you are able to understand this, so that we can go to the next topic. Yes?
Yes.
We can go it right. Abhas, any doubts on this? Abhas, Namrita, Vinay, anything? Any doubts in this journal entry? Because this is one of the most important journal entry. This can come in exam. Okay, cool. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Hope you guys have understood this, because we are following our cash method here. So if you see, the revenue recognition is always subject. See the past key here. Revenue recognition in governmental funds is always subject to modified accrual standard. Receivables are recognized if the government has enforceable claim. Recognized revenues will be adjusted to the amount available through allowance account or deferred inflow of resources, even though the receivable is recognized. Some of the nomenclatures are very, very tough, guys. So I'm just making you simpler in terms of my explanations through cash receipt method. Okay. Now, what is government mandated? So these are very theoretical in nature. So government mandated non-exchange transaction in which a government provide fund and mandate that, boss, this is what you need to clean up. Say such as an environmental cleanup. Tomorrow there is a road cleanup and all, and they tell a particular quantity to clean that particular thing. So that are government mandated non-exchange transactions. What are voluntary non-exchange transactions? It is not. Here what happens is government receives resources, but they do not provide equal value to it. Like grant agreements are there, right? So government gives a grant, or government receives certain grants from the federal government or the state government, so vice versa. But there is no equal exchange for that. So that are known as voluntary non-exchange transactions. Again, we are coming to the revenue recognition requirements. As I said you, the time requirement criteria here, you need to make a note of this. So within 60 days, if you are able to collect, you can recognize revenue for that particular thing. See there, revenues are first recognized in the period in which the resources must be used or when used may begin. See the time requirements. Revenues are first recognized in the period in which resources must be used or use may begin, with emphasis on the time limit associated with them. Generally, the time limit is 60 days, guys. 60 days. Within 60 days, if you are able to collect your receivables, you can recognize that as a revenue. Required characteristic: the resource provider, federal government, specifies certain characteristic for the recipient. The revenue, the entity receiving the revenue must be a local government. Allowable must be incurred before revenue. Okay, there are certain contingencies. So this is what it is there. So both of the following: first is a time requirement, which is 60 days. Second is a modified accrual requirements are met. That is, revenue should be both measurable and available. Clear, guys? Measurable in terms you should raise an invoice. Available in terms you should be able to collect it within 60 days. Either upon satisfaction, governmental fund revenues are subject to basis. Under modified accrual, governmental fund revenues are recorded, which is measurable and available. This usually means a collection period does not exceed 60 days. This is a magical number which you need to remember. 60 days after fiscal year end. If you are able to collect it within that period, you can recognize the revenue for that particular amount. Clear? So see there, billed or recorded equals so real estate. So they have given us a certain summary here. You can always read at your leisure. So again, what are expenditures here? See there, since we are following modified accrual method, we are in the governmental funds chapter only, right? So here, any capital expenditure is treated as expenditure itself. Are you able to understand this, guys? Typically what happens is, any capital expenditure we record it as an asset, right? Here we don't record any asset. We don't record any asset, or fixed asset, or any long-term debt. We all record everything as an expenditure. See there, we don't carry any long-term debt. We doesn't carry any fixed assets. So capital purchases, debt service, operating expenditure, they are all considered as current year expenditure. There is no asset or long-term liability in governmental accounting. Very, very important is this. Please remember this, guys, right? I just skipped this purchase and consumption method. See there, in purchase and consumption method, in purchase method, so how do you recognize these expenditures? Basically, once you have identified the expenditure, either you can record it as an expenditure, and at the year end you can carry it as a current asset if you follow a purchase method. What are the general entries, guys? Debit the expenditure, credit the vouchers payable. At the year end you might have an inventory, but what is the use of that inventory? You cannot spend it. That's why they use the word known as non-spendable fund balance, right? Because you can sell those inventory only in the next year. Till this year it will be considered as closing stock, and thus it is being classified under non-spendable fund balance inventory. Now, what is a consumption method basically? In consumption method, what basically happens is, you carry it as a current asset, right? And then you record it as expenditure. So what is a current asset here? Inventory. So you're debiting inventory, crediting as vouchers payable. And again, when you consume it, you debit your expenditure and you take out your inventory from your books. Guys, any doubts in this purchase method or consumption method? Because this is also a very, very important topic. In the exam, a lot of the journal entries being asked on the purchase method and consumption method. Any doubts in this particular thing, guys? Okay, nothing in terms of, there are no doubts in this particular thing. Okay, good. So regardless of the method used, inventory must be balanced with the non-spendable fund balance amount to ensure the unassigned fund balances represent available resources. Okay, that's fine. So what are the classifications? So classification of governmental expenditure, they can be classified function-wise, program-wise, organization unit, you have activities, you have character, you have object classes. That's okay, that's not so important. So illustration 3, see that if a governmental fund purchases a new police car for $25,000, the governmental fund general entry, what do they record? See, they don't book and asset. Basically, the book is as expenditure only. See that they have debited expenditure in this case. Because in governmental funds, we use as what method? Modified accrual method. So we will expense out all the fixed asset acquisitions. Typically, we don't carry any fixed asset in our balance sheet. That's the reason why your expenditure, the entire police car is being expensed out instead of carrying it as an asset. Very, very important is this point. See that governmental funds, which is GRASP, we use as a modified accrual, and the expenditure fixed asset acquisition consistent with the current financial resource measurement focus. The fixed assets are reported on the governmental wide financial statement. Proprietary and fiduciary funds uses which method? Full accrual, and they will report fixed assets, but governmental funds won't report. See there, governmental funds are MAC GRASP, modified accrual accounting, current financial resource. They don't carry any non-current asset or liability, so you won't have any fixed assets. Please remember this. So if you have purchased a police car, it will, the expenditure will be debited in this particular case. Okay, what are the proceeds from long-term debts? Again, because you don't carry any long-term debt, see the journal entry, there is no liability. What they are doing is they are crediting to your P&L account. See there, they are debiting, they are crediting it as income. They are not carrying a long-term debt payable or something. Debit cash and credit is a direct income. See there, guys, you don't have any long-term debt because we are following which method? Modified accrual method, which is current financial resources measurement focus. Clear? Okay, guys, what is the question number one answer? Yes, question number one answer. What is question number one answer, guys? Yes, Ajay, Abbas, Vinay, what is the question number one answer? Rich Township governing body adopted its general fund budget for the year ended July 31st, year one, composed of estimated revenues of $1 lakh and appropriations of $80,000. See there, to record the appropriation of $80,000, what should we do, guys? What should be debited and what should be credited? What is our journal entry? Credit estimated expenditure control. One is telling A, credit the appropriation control. See there, whenever we are doing, we are recording it as, so the first journal entry, what do? We set it as, it is a opposite side. So you debit the revenue, you debit the revenue and you credit the appropriation. See there, book the budget. How did we book the budget journal entry? So I'm straight away taking to that. See the journal entry, estimated revenue control was debited, revenue was debited. We book on the opposite side when we are booking a budget. This is an opening entry, guys. So you debit estimated revenue control and you credit appropriations control. Correct, Abbas? A is the correct answer. So you will debit what actually? You will credit appropriations control. What's the question number two answer, guys? A second. Yes, what's the question number two answer? Yes, Ajay, Abbas, Vinay, what's the question number two answer? Sripal Township governing body adopted its general fund budget for the year ended July 31st, year one, composed of estimated revenues of $1 lakh and appropriation of $80,000, right? Which formally integrates this, which formally integrates a budget into the accounting records to record the $20,000 budgeted excess of estimated revenue over operations. What's the journal entry we will pass? Yes, guys, what's the answer? C, but not sure. No, C cannot be the correct answer because here he is asking about, okay, he is asking about the $20,000 budgeted excess. Yes, C, budgetary control is the correct answer. Actually, you will credit the budgetary control C there, because you have revenues more over appropriations. So typically when that is a thing, you will credit the, you have a surplus or not, guys? See there, he have, see, basically he had $1 lakh as $1 lakh as approved spending, but how much did they spend actually? $80,000 only, right? So $20,000 have not been spent basically, right? So that is why it is a, it is an excess surplus. So it's a $20,000 which is not being spent, so that should be credited. What this is first entry, no, sir? Yes, that's the first entry. That's the opening entry itself. So you will debit the appropriation, you will debit the revenue, you will credit the budgetary control, you will credit the excess budgetary control on the surplus or deficit. That is what you will get in this particular thing. Okay. Yes, question number three, guys. What's the answer for question number three?
Answer is C.
Yes, answer is C. That's correct, guys. Very, very simple question, but they have asked a lot of times in CPA exam, because if someone doesn't remember the concept, he can go in for a toss here. Because what I said, that within 60 days, if you can collect, you can recognize that as a revenue. So 5 lakh plus 1 lakh, 6 lakhs is the answer. So option C is the correct answer. Good, Vinay. Good, Ajay. Good, Abbas. Correct answer. Yes, question number 4. What's the answer, guys? Come on, guys, this is a very simple question. They are asking how much the Dane County, which is a governmental unit, report as expenditures in the governmental fund. What do you think, guys, how much should be the expenditure? Correct, D is the correct answer, guys. See there, payment of principal on long-term debt is also an expenditure. Please remember, jab hum log accrual concept follow karte the, payment of principal would never used to come in the P&L account. It was never used to be appearing in P&L account, because it used to go from the balance sheet itself and it used to reduce your debt obligation. But here, payment of, since it's a modified accrual basis method, so even payment of principal, payment to vendors, purchase of computer, everything is an expenditure. Yes, that's the correct answer. Correct, Abbas. So you will record all 5 lakhs plus 1 lakh plus 3 lakh, 9 lakh rupees as expenditure itself. You won't have a bifurcation between a capital expenditure or a revenue expenditure. Please remember yours, because we are following what method? We are following accrual basis, modified accrual basis method. Clear? Yes, question number 5, guys. What is the answer? Yes, guys, what's the answer for question number 5? Don't know this one, sir. It is inappropriate to record depreciation expense. See, guys, always when you are not able to understand, remember the mnemonic which is used. See, their governmental funds are MAC GRASPY. So GRASPY mein kya kya aare? G stands for general fund, R stands for special revenue fund, debt service fund, capital project fund, permanent fund. What did I tell you, guys? You never record a fixed asset in governmental funds. Is the concept clear, guys, here? See, in this question, they are asking that you will record, it is inappropriate to record depreciation expense. Now tell me, guys, after listening this concept, in which fund you will not account for asset? Yes. Guys, tell me the answer. We want the answer for this. Yes, capital project funds is a correct answer. Good of us. That's a correct answer, guys. So capital project fund comes under the mnemonic GRASP. See there? It comes under GRASP, G-R-S. See the P there? P stands for capital project fund. So capital project fund follows which method? They follow modified accrual method. So under modified accrual method, you will never record non-current. You will always record current. That is the reason why you will not record depreciation expense under capital project fund. That's all we had from module 3. Any doubts on this, guys? We are going to now to module 4. So what we have done in module 3 is we have booked the budget. Now we are booking a... Yes, nice question. Yes, it's a conceptual question of us. Basically, that's why your concepts need to be clear. I think that's the reason why I'm taking a webinar here. Hopefully, I'm doing a justice by explaining this, one of the toughest chapters of governmental accounting, because we have never come across this in India. Even in the US also, students never have come across in their exam, in their intermediate or graduation on governmental accounting. That's the reason why we have taken this concept. No, that's fine, Abbas. So now we are coming to encumbrances, guys. This is one of the most important modules. You might be absent for any of the modules, I don't care. But encumbrances is one of the most tougher ones. Very, very important. So see there in encumbrances. Encumbrances is nothing but a commitment by a government that they will spend certain amount on that particular funds. So it's like a purchase order. You have muted me from your side, I guess. Hello? Yeah, Ajay. Hello? Hello?
Yeah, I'm good now. Actually, I wanted to answer, but since it was a mute, I was unable to answer.
Okay. That's fine. Okay. Now we are following the encumbrances method. Guys, encumbrances, so here you need to be very careful in encumbrances, because these are the general entries. Even the moment you raise a PO, so it's like a commitment, right? So the moment you raise a PO, you will pass a journal entry for this. So encumbrances, normally what we spoke about, BAE, the mnemonic is B stands for book a budget, A stands for activity, E stands for encumbrances. So we are in the encumbrances and we are under governmental accounting chapter only. See there, just to summarize you, because this is so extensive to remember. That's why we are doing with mnemonic with Becker help. See there, G stands G, R, S, P, P, GRASP, MAC, GRASP. So governmental funds are MAC, GRASP. So governmental funds use which method? BAE, book an activity, book a budget, book an activity, book an encumbrances. So we are under encumbrances here. Clear? So see there. So what is a journal entry? So this is a first question, very, very important illustration one. A mandatory one question will come from this particular section or this particular module. It is a mandatory one or two multiple choice questions might come from encumbrances. So let us concentrate on this. So see there, assume that Progressive Township has budgeted or appropriated $1 lakh for the purchase of 2 sanitation trucks. So how much they have appropriated? They have actually budgeted how much? Basically, they have budgeted $1 lakh, right? They assume that a purchase order is issued to purchase the 2 sanitation trucks at an estimated cost of how much, guys? $45,000 each. Okay, so government have got $1 lakh, right? So out of that, they have spent how much actually? 90,000 they have earmarked. Encumbrances are nothing but earmarked. You have actually committed for that particular amount. So how much is a purchase order? See, jaise hi hum log ek purchase order raise karte hain, ek legal obligation rehta hai. That's the reason why purchase order ka entry jab rehta, that's the reason why I think we pass a journal entry for that. So here we are debiting the encumbrances because that's a commitment, and we have credited the budgetary control here. That is a journal entry we will do, because here we are, encumbrances is something like an expenditure. That's the reason why we have debited encumbrances with 90,000. Guys, you, when you reverse the journal entry, as we have seen in budgets, you will also reverse here with the same amount. Please remember this. If you have passed, because you will need to reverse this encumbrances and pass the actual amount. Right? Abhi sirf hum log estimations kar rahe hai purchase order ke hisab se, ki bhai $90,000 ka kharcha hoga. So I have debited encumbrances, I have credited budgetary control. Now when the invoice is received for one of the trucks at an actual cost of $44,000, now what will I pass? We will pass a journal entry now. So expenditure we will debit, we will credit voucher payable or cash with $44,000. Sir, why 44,000? If 80 truck ka invoice receive hua hai. Till I don't receive an invoice, I can't book an expenditure. Is it clear, guys? So I've received an invoice for one truck, which is $44,000. So I should reverse that particular truck or not, guys? Because now I'll have to reverse out of this 90,000, 45,000 with the same amount. Yes or no? In budgets also, we reverse with the same amount. In encumbrances also, we will reverse with the same amount. Out of 90,000, you will reverse out $45,000 because you have received one truck here now, right? So what is the actual expenditure? You have debited expenditure, you have credited cash with the actual amount, 44,000 and 44,000. See there, they have given a pass key. So what have happened? By 1 lakh was appropriation. Government had 1 lakh. Government had 1 lakh. Out of this, 90,000 was earmarked, guys. Yes. So they have earmarked 90,000. Now they are left out with how much actually? Only $10,000. Right. And out of that $10,000, they got out of that 45 and 44, still $1,000 they have still left with them. Guys, are you able to understand? Because one truck was reversed out. So you are left out. So in that one truck which you have received, out of that 44,000, out of that 45,000 which you have reversed, you have expended out how much? Only 44,000. So $1,000 is still, you are able to receive it, guys, right? So you have still $1,000 with you. So 10,000 plus 1,000, $11,000 will be unexpended appropriation, right? So 10,000 you have not appropriated. Out of 45, 44 you have booked an actual expenditure, so you are left out with 1,000. So 10,000 plus 1,000 is $11,000. So this is your unexpended appropriation. Guys, quickly, anyone having doubts in this, guys, this is a very, very tough concept. So I just want you guys to ask as many questions as possible on this particular thing. Yes, Abhas, Vinay, do you understand the concept? Dekho bhai, pehle 1 lakh you had the budget appropriation. Out of that you spent 45,000. Out of that you have spent 90,000. You have earmarked 2 purchase orders. So you cannot use that 2 purchase orders because you have received the purchase orders. So it has been committed. What is not committed is, out of that $10,000 is unappropriated amount. And out of that 45,000, 44,000 you have recorded an activity. So actual expenditure account, still $1,000 you can spend. So overall, $11,000 you can spend, right? Any doubts on this, guys? Any doubts on encumbrances? Abhas, Vinay, I think some of the participants have gone out again. Yes, Abhas, Vinay. Okay. I think there are no doubts. We can go into the next one. Okay, so what are the encumbrances which are outstanding at the year end? So that is, this is for the second truck, guys. So this, what you're seeing, this journal entry, because you have already reversed for the first truck. Now this is for the second truck. You will have to reverse with the same amount, right? And there was a purchase order entry which you have already passed. Now that to close that budgetary account related to the outstanding purchase orders, you will debit the unassigned fund balance, because that you cannot assign to anything. So you have debited unassigned and you have credited the fund balance which is committed, right? So you will pass one more fresh entry, which is unassigned fund balance debit with 45, and you'll credit the fund balance committed with 45, right? So this is the journal entry which you will pass. There are, again, see there, they have given a budget which is of $1 lakh. You have expended out 44,000. See there, this already we calculated unexpended appropriation of 11,000, but we are going into the fund balance. So basically you had a cash of $1 lakh. You have recorded an activity of 44,000. You are left out with $56,000 cash. And again, out of this $1 lakh, which is unassigned, of that 44,000 activities, 44,000 you have already done it. So you are left out with $56,000 unapproved spending. Out of that 56,000, 45,000 is again earmarked for the second draft. So you are left out with $11,000 unassigned, right? So this is the thing which you need to remember. And now in the next year, when you will get that particular track, now in the next year, it will be acting as an expenditure. So you debit the expenditure, you will credit the voucher payable with $45,000. So you will debit expenses and credit vouchers payable. This is a general entry to record the receipt of last year item, right? So this is prior year expenditure because you already had earmarked it last year. Okay guys, so now we are going into the second example number one. So a country's balance in the general fund, see there, he have appropriations of $7,45,000. Just a second. He have encumbrances, so he have committed how much actually out of that? $37,250. And expenditure he have $2,98,000. So you need to deduct that also. So remaining how much appropriation you have? $7,45,000, you deduct $2,98,000, you deduct $37,250. Your remaining available appropriations is 409,750. Guys, any logic why we have not deducted vouchers payable of 55,875, guys? Yes, Vinay, Abhas. Abhas, Vinay, why didn't we deduct 55,875? Vinay, why didn't we deduct 55,875? If you see there, out of see government had 7,45,000 as budget. Usme se 2,98,000 they have already expensed out, or and also they had 37,250 which is committed. Encumbrances matlab kya hai? Commitment ki tarah, purchase order ki tarah, right? So that also is being deducted. What my question is, why didn't we deduct 55,875 as voucher payable? Please remember this, guys. Here 55,875 is already included under 2,98,000. So that's the reason why we didn't deduct 55,875 again. See the entry when we passed, expenditure we debited and voucher payable we credited. Yes or no, guys? So here 55,875 is already included in 2,98,000. So that's why we didn't deduct that. And this is a remaining available balance after appropriations, which is 409,750. Right? So remember to close the budget, close the activity and close the encumbrances. Do not try to net them. Budget is booked. Budget is closed for the same amount. Activity is booked. Activity is closed for the actual amount. Encumbrances are booked and encumbrances are reversed for the same amount. Yes. Question number one, guys. What's the answer? What do you think? The moment when they issue a purchase order for supplies, what is the entry you will pass? Which account should be credited?
Which internal account should link township credit purchase order budget control team?
Yes, which account we should credit, guys?
Purchase order.
You will debit the encumbrances and you will credit what actually? Budgetary control. Yes or no? See the encumbrances journal entry what we passed. See the journal entry you have. First journal entry is encumbrances is debited for the moment they issue the purchase order and you have credited what? Budgetary control. That's the reason why. That's the reason why we have credited the budgetary control. Option D is the correct answer, guys. Yes. Now second question. Now ELM city issued a purchase order for the supplies with an estimated cost of $5,000. When the supplies were received, the accompanying invoice indicated an actual price of $4,950. What amount should ELM debit to the budgetary control after the supplies and invoices were received? The moment the invoice received, what should we do, guys? How much amount should we credit to the budgetary control?
Elmer City should have purchase order with an estimate of sales when the supplies were received. The company invoice indicated an actual price of $4,950. What amount should debit to the budgetary control after the supplies and invoice were received? 4950.
No, that is an activity journal entry. What he's basically asking is budgetary control. In activity, what is a journal entry we pass as? It is debit expenditure, credit, voucher payment. This is an actual expenditure journal entry. What he's basically looking for is a budgetary control journal entry.
5,000 then.
See guys, what amount should ELM debit or credit to the budgetary control? It will be $5,000 only. Yes or no guys? Because debit encompasses credit, budgetary control. When you want to reverse it, again you will reverse with debit, budgetary control and credit the encumbrances. That's how you will cancel the journal entry for the encumbrances. Very, very important guys. Question number two is most important question. Please do prepare for this question number two. Yes. Okay guys, that's all we have from today. Basically, because I think we are closing off with the last part of this interfund loans and interfund services provided and all, right? So what are the other transactions and events? So interfund activity. So basically, this is what, this is an activity between the funds. So when you have interfund loans, this is just recorded as a fund transfer journal entry. One fund is giving a loan to another fund. This is just basically acting like a fund transfer journal entry. Are you able to understand this? And interfund services provided and used, that will be acting like a revenue. Because if one fund is providing services to another fund, it will take form of revenue. It doesn't take form of transfer entry. In interfund loans, you will have a fund transfer entry. In interfund services, you will have revenue entry. Please be careful in the journal entry, because they might ask a journal entry where there is an interfund services provided and used. You need to be very, very careful. You need to credit revenue in such cases. You cannot give just transfer entry, debit that fund and credit cash. That's not a pure transfer entry. See, their unrealizable balances are reclassified as transfers in case of interfund loans. And in case of interfund services, transactions of these types are accounted for as revenues and expenses or expenditures. What is non-reciprocal interfund activity? So they are those interfund transfers, they are those interfund reimbursements, right? So it is like you'll have non-reciprocal interfund activity. Here you had reciprocal interfund activity. See, there in non-reciprocal interfund activity, you do not give back actually. In reciprocal interfund activity, if a fund is transferring something, the other fund also provide some services to it. But in non-reciprocal, it will not happen. See, if a government is collecting taxes from it, it doesn't give you out again anything else, right, in terms of money. So there is no reciprocation in terms of non-reciprocal interfund. See, their payment in lieu of taxes made by proprietary fund to general fund or a budgeted transfer of pledge revenues to a debt service on to meet debt covenant, transfers are normally displayed as other financing sources. See there, and they are used as after non-operating. So interfund transfers are used as other financing sources. Very, very important. If there is a fund transfer, this will be other financing sources. In case of flows of assets, in case of non-reciprocal activity, you will use in journal entry the word known as other financing sources. In case of interfund activity, interfund loan, you will use what actually interfund receivables and payables, and it will be classified as a mere transfers. What is interfund reimbursement, guys? So this is a payment of expenses made by one fund on the behalf of another fund. So it's like a pure reimbursement, guys. Agar main kuch kharcha kar raha hu, to dusra banda mera kharcha bear kar raha hai. So it is bearing, it is taking an expense hit on behalf of another fund. So that fund needs to reimburse them that for that particular expenditure, because that's not their expenditure, right? Okay. So that's all we had from this. So there is something called deferred inflow and deferred outflow that are not so relevant, but still I would tell it works like a deferred revenue concept only. We have certain handmade notes which we could send you guys. You can just send your email ID. I can just send you that summary notes which we have prepared for this entire F9 chapter, right? So this is about F9 today. That's all we have from our session. So module 5 and module 6 are more of a theoretical in nature. You guys can study it accordingly. There is nothing rocket science in module 5 and module 6. It's very, very easy. So just let me know if you are not able to understand anything. I can definitely help you out, guys. You have my email ID, you have my WhatsApp number as well. So whenever you have any doubts, just give me a ring or just give me a message. I'll definitely help you out. That's not a problem. Thank you, guys. Thanks a lot. Hope you had a very good time, guys. Thank you.